Hello everyone and welcome back to the Scale Model Medic YouTube channel for part one of a small series of videos paying tribute to my favourite game, which is Playerunknown's Battlegrounds. And in this particular video, I'll be building the UAZ 469. If you're not familiar with Playerunknown's Battlegrounds, or PUBG as it's also known, it's a battle royale style game in which around 100 players parachute into a variety of maps, either alone or as part of a squad, before arming themselves with an assortment of weapons and heading out to try and murder the other 100 players and be the last man or the last squad standing to take the win. The game does have some other bizarre distractions, but otherwise it's an absolutely fantastic game and it's very rewarding to play. To get around the maps a bit quicker, there are a variety of vehicles, my favourite of which is the humble UAZ Soviet era off-road vehicle, which is the subject of this video. Now, not every modeler would agree with me, but I actually think that Trumpeter make really good kits and I really enjoy building them. So I'd had this idea for a Battlegrounds diorama in the back of my mind for years now, and when I saw that Trumpeter made a UAZ 469, I don't know how I'd missed it before, but I decided that I was going to grab one of these kits, it's number 02327, and I was going to get to work straight away. It arrived in nice individual bags, all the moulding was really good, there was extra foam wrapped around areas where the moulding was particularly detailed and the kit was fragile. And I also, with a little bit of relief, found that the chassis was moulded in one piece. The GAZ-66 that I built for the Chernobyl video came with a multi-part chassis and you had to make sure that everything was really well aligned, as any misalignment would follow through the rest of the build. The single piece roof was well textured with some small folds and ripples in the cloth, not as ragged as the model from the game, but you know, good enough. There was a small photo etch fret in there as well, with lots of the finer details and some mesh grills for up front. I thought it was a nice touch that Trumpeter had wrapped some of the sprues themselves with foam where the details were particularly tiny, as this prevented any damage, and the kit did come with 5 rubber or vinyl tyres, I can't tell which one's which, but they were well moulded and the seam ran around the tread so it would be easy to remove. The kit comes with a fully detailed engine and it does have the option to mould it with the bonnet up, but that's not something you see in the game, so I was actually going to skip straight to these portions here and start my build with the chassis and leave this whole engine construction out, only allowing the visible parts which go up towards the engine itself to be built, as these can be seen on the underside at the sides of the vehicle. So I was skipping a big part of the assembly and just going with what you could see. Assembly itself was actually pretty unremarkable, everything fit really well, there was just lots of clean up on really small parts, so I only rolled the camera for this section here and there just to grab a bit of footage for this section of the video. I worked in sub-assemblies, positioned everything carefully, but I really didn't have any issues whatsoever. Some of the really fine parts on the interior had the sprue connection point right in the middle of the piece, so that took some care and patience cleaning up, but the fit was brilliant, so once they were sorted out they just dropped straight into place. The seats on this kit impressed me in particular, having built the older GAZ-66 model. The interior on that kit was really blocky and basic. This kit has got a set of really nice tubular frames for the seats made up of several different components, and there's even a little bit of photo etch on the fret to add to the seat frames just to boost the detail levels a little bit. I added a few drops of CA around the raised bolt details which would go through the holes on the photo etch piece, and then I used one of these pickup pencils from Ultimate Modeling Products just to guide the brass into place. There were 2 of these separate PE parts per seat, one on each side, so 4 in total. It was a little bit finicky, but it really did boost the overall look of the interior. And vehicles from this period were really bare and basic on the inside, so it was nice to have that space under the seat, which gave it a more realistic look. Normally, the kit manufacturers would sort of cut corners in these areas and have a big blocky piece under the seat. Moving on with the build, there was a lot of masking to do, so I got busy with the yellow tape, burnishing it down into the raised window frames with a cocktail stick before trimming off with a knife. Obviously, anything not covered by the tape would pick up primer and base coat, so wouldn't be transparent when the model was painted. With the side windows masked up and glued into place, I just had to add these tiny details for the window winders and the door handles on the inside of the doors before proceeding with the build. The wheel assembly was really straightforward, consisting of just three pieces, a little dab of extra thin around the lip on one of the wheel parts, and then press the two halves together, and that join line would be hidden by the tyre, so no cleanup needed there. And then the rear part of the wheel is the bit that goes on the axle, so that won't be seen when the model's together. So that was really roughly cleaned up, and I added plenty of glue just to keep it in place. Once the wheels had fully cured, I pressed the rubber or vinyl tyres onto them, and I was pleased to see that they fit perfectly with no gaps around the outside whatsoever. I didn't even need to glue these in place as they were a really snug fit, and I don't know what they're made of, but I really liked the way they looked, and I decided that I wouldn't paint them and I would skip straight to the weathering stages on the wheels. On the rear screen, I ran into a bit of a problem, as the frame around the outside of the screen wasn't actually a raised detail, so I couldn't buff masking tape in there and trim round like I would normally. I toyed with the idea of adding a spacer onto the side of my scalpel and using this to guide me around the outside of the window so that I could leave the frame unmasked, but this idea didn't pan out as I couldn't go around the corners smoothly. I ended up creating this weird looking support and then putting tape on the inside of the roof, and then rested the roof moulding on top of that little platform and cut around the window opening using a scalpel. Because the screen fits into a recess on the outside of the roof, the actual opening was the correct size of the glass and the frame was in the recess, so if this worked I would end up with a template which would cover up the clear bit in the middle and leave the frame exposed so it could pick up the paint that I wanted it to. Once it was in place, it actually worked perfectly and the frame was still exposed. I glued the screen into place and moved on with the build. I wanted the model to have working mirrors, so I purchased this self-adhesive mirror film from Amazon and decided to stick that in place to see how it looked. To create the right shape, I buffed some masking tape down into the mirror parts and then trimmed around this with a scalpel. This would do two things: it would form a template that I could cut around to get the right shape, and it would also double as masking to keep the mirrors covered up while I painted the vehicle. After cutting around the tape, this was then transferred onto the mirror film and then pushed down into place and used as a guide to cut a rough piece of the mirror out, which I could then trim down to shape more accurately. Because the film was quite thick and stiff, I was able to sand the tight curves onto the corners using an Ultimate Modelling Products sanding stick, and I ended up with a shape which fit perfectly into the recessed area on the wing mirrors. This was a finicky process, but I felt like the mirrors would add a nice touch to the vehicle, so I persevered, and I cut out one piece for each wing mirror, and I also did the rear view mirror on the interior, even though chances are this will never be seen. Here you can see the three mirrors in place, all masked up, along with the rest of the interior detail. I also masked up the recesses for the seats to get a good glue join, and I put some cocktail stick ends in the holes for the rear seats. With all the sub-assemblies complete and all the masking in place, it was time to move on and prime the model. I decided that instead of using my trusty UMP black primer, I would try out using Mr. Finishing Surfacer 1500 in black, which is a lacquer-based primer. To get the surfacer ready for the airbrush, it had to be thinned down, and for this I used Mr. Colour Levelling Thinners. This is a lacquer thinner with a drying retardant, so it stays wet for longer and settles down to a nice smooth finish. It also produces horrific fumes, so I got masked up, and in the background you can see an extractor unit which was also used to remove any of those bad smells. This was a gift from Al at International Scale Modeler, for which I'm eternally grateful, as it enables me to use lacquer paints now and try these new things, so many thanks to you, Al. After diluting the surfacer 50-50 with the lacquer thinner, I started to do some consistency tests by running some drops down the side of the glass, and once I got it to what I felt was about right, I grabbed the Harder and Steenbeck Infinity with the 0.4mm nozzle loaded in it, and I started to prime the model. Not being familiar with Mr. Surfacer, I started on the underside and I started trying to get a bit of a feel for how it sprayed and whether my mixture was settling down smoothly. Using this stuff was a bit different to my usual priming routine, which involves blasting UMP's excellent primer at the model using an absolute hosepipe of an airbrush, the Badger 105 Patriot. I had to build the colour up more gradually, which did take longer, and I also had to use better spray discipline, moving smoothly around the model to keep my applications nice and even. After a while, I found myself slipping into old habits and hosing the primer on. Luckily, this was on the less visible areas at this point, but even so, I had to check myself before I went ahead and did anything stupid on the exterior of the model, and I got myself back into a rhythm of using tighter spray discipline to apply thinner coats. I worked my way around, just giving everything a bit of a mist and then blocking the colour in a little bit more solid once it had settled down for a few seconds. I did this two or three times just to make sure everything was covered, and I had to change angles frequently just to make sure that all those nooks and crannies, particularly on the interior, were covered. With the primer complete, it was time to choose a base colour, and rather than going off the colour callouts in the kit instructions, I went by eye from the game screenshots that I'd taken, and I settled on H302 from the Mr. Hobby Aqueous range, but more on colour choice later. I thinned this down for the airbrush with Ultimate Modelling Products airbrush thinners, and got to work on the underside of the vehicle just to make sure that my spray was settling down nice and smooth, before I progressed on to paint the rest of the sub-assemblies in the H302 green. For the first time of many in this build, I had to stop and repair one of these really delicate wing mirrors that my clumsy fingers had managed to snap off. But after that was fixed back into place, I carried on with the H302, moving through the interior and making sure that everything was nicely covered. At this point, I was still happy with my colour choice, so I carried on with the exterior of the vehicle, and as I've come to expect, with Mr. Hobby Aqueous thinned with UMP thinner, I was left with a really nice smooth base coat. Using Army Painter War Paints, matte white and matte black, I mixed up a nice dark grey and I used this to block in the seat cushions. I used a large brush for good coverage and to get the job done nice and quickly, but I did take extra care around the outside of the cushions just to make sure I didn't get any of the dark grey on the really nice seat frame details. There's only one decal for the interior, which covers the whole dashboard, including all of the switches and indicator lights above and below those dials in the centre. Because these were on a decal, I felt like they wouldn't settle down very well, even using Microsol, so I cut the dials from the sheet and used the decal for these pieces only, deciding to paint in the switches and the indicator lights with a brush later on. I slipped these decals into position using Microset, and then I applied Microsol to get them to settle down into the raised details on the dashboard. With the decals in place and everything painted, I wanted to do some rudimentary weathering on the interior, just so it looked a little bit used in the areas which you could see through the windows once the vehicle was closed up. I used some dark streaking grime from MIG Ammo, and I diluted it with Humbrol enamel thinners, and I just flowed this straight over the top of the raw paint. I didn't use any gloss coat or anything, and you can see that it's actually soaking into the paint a little bit rather than just flowing along the recesses like it would if I had applied a gloss coat. I used this to my advantage and soaked the thinners in, and then did a little bit of a mapping effect by dabbing in some heavier concentrations in different areas. I built the effect up gradually before switching over to normal streaking grime and mixing in some MIG pigments old rust to create myself a bit of a rusty wash using the enamels as a fixer. I dabbed this into the deeper corners, but I didn't go over the top with it as I didn't want the interior to look too rusty. Even though the rust effect was helping to break up the interior a little bit, it wasn't really boosting the contrast in the way that I would have liked. I concentrated the effect on the higher use areas, such as under the pedals and on the floor of the rear bed, and then I switched over to using Citadel's Nuln Oil. This is a black acrylic wash, but it dries really smoothly with nice gradients in it, and I added this to the dashboard on the raised details and around the steering wheel, and I also flowed some into the deep grooves on the interior. This just darkened the paint in that area and just boosted the contrast that little bit and helped the raised details stand out. I did a little bit more of the mapping effect by adding the wash over in a large area and then going back and dabbing some more in. I concentrated this around the seams, and because I'd pre-wet the area with the wash, it flowed along the raised details nicely and just helped pick out those lines. To add a bit of dirt, I used Turn Dirt from MIG Ammo, which I used a lot on my recent Hitachi excavator video, and after diluting it with some Humbrol enamel thinners, I flowed it into areas where dirt would have collected. With the basic weathering completed on the inside, I glued the seats into place and I decided to get the vehicle closed up so I could concentrate on the exterior. The roof needed to be painted next, and for some reason I started following the full colour sheet from the kit rather than the game screenshots, and I painted the roof with Citadel's Steel Legion Drab. Whilst this is a good match for the brown on the colour callout sheet, it's nothing like the game screenshots at all. So after thinning the paint with Ultimate Modelling Products Airbrush Thinner and giving it a good airbrushing, even though the paint had settled down really well and it did look good compared to the sheet in the kit, it was totally the wrong colour. I had a very strong word with myself and then mixed up a dark greenish grey using a Baden Black, Skull White and a little bit of Death World Green, all from Citadel and thinned with UMP's airbrush thinners and repainted the roof. Once this was completed, I decided to have another look at those game screenshots and yet again had another strong word with myself, as the green I'd chosen for the body of the vehicle just wasn't right and H65 from Mr. Hobby Aqueous was a much better colour match. I decided that rather than carry on with a colour I didn't like, I would repaint. I know that this is a real weird backwards step, however, I would rather do this and take the time and effort to repaint now than go ahead and finish a vehicle in a colour that I just didn't like. With the masking still in place, I picked out the window seals with Army Painter Matte Black, and I used the same black to paint in the wing mirrors before removing the masking. And it was time to say goodbye to all that interior detail by adding the roof. At this point, things started to go a little bit wrong for me, as it looks like I drifted out of alignment early on and I was left with some horrific gaps. This gap down here by the rear door I was actually okay with after checking the game screenshots. This appears on the game model. I'm glad of this because fixing this would have been an absolute nightmare with it being right next to a clear part and quite deeply recessed. But this gap up the front was really visible and shouldn't be there, so it had to be fixed. To initially fill that gap I used epoxy putty, so after mixing the two parts together, and not for the first time in my life, I was left with a tiny droopy sausage between my fingers, which would be used to fill the gap initially before using Mr. Surfacer. By using the epoxy putty in this way, I was able to deal with the really deep gap between the two parts first, before switching to using Mr. Surfacer 500 to recontour the roof. Because Mr. Surfacer isn't really a filler, it does shrink quite a bit, and this would have resulted in having loads of ghost seams later on if I hadn't used the putty to fill that really deep gap first. I built up loads of Mr. Surfacer 500 along the leading edge and then moved my way backwards towards the roof until I had enough of it on there that I could sand it down and get the contour correct. In the end, I got the shape about right, including the change in contour on the edges where it meets the windscreen corners, and it was time to reprime and repaint and check whether I'd blended incorrectly. Unfortunately, some dust did manage to get inside the vehicle and I wouldn't be able to deal with this, so I'd have to live with my mistake later on. The whole area was primed again with Mr. Surfacer 1500 and allowed to dry so I could check for any seams. Initially, it looked like there was a bit of a step in there, however this turned out to be just primer build-up, and a quick run over with a UMP sanding sponge got everything nice and smooth. I actually ended up being really glad that I'd took the time to do this, even though it was an unwanted step, as the roof now looked way more like a canvas stretched over the car body than the original kit parts would have done. It did cause some unwanted damage, so I had to break out the H65 Mr. Hobby Aqueous to do some touch-ups. However, in the end, the result was much better than if I'd just used the original kit parts, so I was really quite pleased that I took the time to go ahead and fix that mistake. The masking was removed from the headlights and the indicators, but I wasn't out of the woods yet as far as masking was concerned, as the Battlegrounds UAZ has a white stripe along the side which needed to be carefully masked off. I propped the vehicle up on a spool of wire and then decanted some basic hairspray before airbrushing this on to facilitate the chipping of the white stripes later on. You can see this is quite heavy in the game screenshots I've posted. For the white, I used Citadel's Pallid Witch Flesh, which is a bit of an off-white and wouldn't be quite so stark against the dark green of the vehicle. Because of the shape of the UAZ, I knew I was going to get some paint going on under the tape, but this could be fixed with a brush later on, so I concentrated on getting good coverage before whizzing the masking tape off to see what the finished effect looked like. As I expected, there were a couple of areas that looked a little bit rough, but overall it had worked out quite well, so I repeated the process on the opposite side. I masked everything off, added a couple of layers of hairspray, and then got some coverage with the Citadel Pallid Witch Flesh. When this was dry, I peeled off the masking tape and sat back to admire my handiwork. The bit that I liked the most was the way I'd managed to snap off both of the wing mirrors yet again. These were starting to do my head in now, so I decided that these mirrors were going to be left off until the end of the build, as I was getting sick of gluing them back on. I added the water over the top of the white stripe to reactivate the hairspray, and to get things moving, I used a finely pointed cocktail stick to concentrate the chipping in the areas where it can be seen the most on the game screenshots. I had a bit more masking to do after that, as in the game it looks like the civilian owners have added a bit of red oxide primer. I mixed some Citadel Mephiston Red and Gorthor Brown to a rough red oxide colour and masked off and airbrushed this on. Once this was peeled off, I had to repeat the process a couple more times in various areas, but all in all, that was the overall painting complete. With the wheels, windscreen wipers and yet again the wing mirrors all glued on, the overall construction was complete and I was ready to move on to the weathering stages. In the Battlegrounds game, the paintwork on these cars is all beat up, so I had loads of weathering effects to add to the base colour to get it looking more like the cars from the game. I also needed to do some oil staining around the wheel hubs, and I was going to add some dust effects as well, all of which I'll cover in the next part of the video. As always guys, thanks very much for watching, and I hope that I'm keeping the pace with the content a little bit, so it shouldn't be too long before my next upload, and as always I really appreciate your support in returning to the channel to watch my videos. So thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you again next time.